All right, packet people, so let's get some hands-on with some more malware with Wireshark. So in this example, we're going to be taking a look at some Agent Tesla traffic that was executed in a controlled environment. So thanks to Brad Duncan and the team at Palo Alto who are giving us these kinds of examples that we can tinker with. So let's go ahead and head out to malwaretrafficanalysis.net. If you hit the click here on traffic analysis exercises, this is an exercise that was posted not long ago. We can come up here and we can actually download this PCAP. Now, one reason why I really like these examples is that, first of all, real world. This is actual malware that is out there running around, gives us an idea of what to look for on the wire. And this is also a fun way to sharpen our Wireshark skills. So on one screen, I have the PCAP open, and on another, I have the questions for the exercise that walks us through. Now, I've also included the questions in the description down below, so you can go ahead and take a look below this video to follow along. Now, if you go to that link, there's also an answer key. Now, I don't want you to be tempted to click that too soon. Really try to walk through this exercise on your own, then compare your answers later. It's getting that mental exercise is what's going to help you be a better analyst. So the first question, when did the malicious traffic start in UTC? So in order to do this with Wireshark, first I have to make sure that my time column is set up according to UTC. If it's not, if it's set up just running total of time or seconds since start of capture, which is the default setting, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come up here, I'm going to go to view, I'm going to come down to time display format, and I'm going to hit UTC time of day. So I could also, if I want to, add date, time of day, year, day of year, and so on. Let's just go time of day. And I can see that the beginning DNS conversation and then this ensuing TCP conversation begins at 22:51:00. So that's the UTC time that this all started. The next question, what's the victim's IP address? Now, just glancing at this, I can see that I have a private address space over here, 192.168.1.27. Something I'll do, though, is I come up here to statistics and I come down here to conversations. And let me go ahead and bring this in. If I come over here to IPv4, I can see that this 1.27 is involved in all the conversations. So it's very likely that that is my client side, the one that actually is infected and generating this traffic. Next, what's the MAC address? Well, same thing, could just come over here to Ethernet. And I can see here the one that is the top talker. This is this BCEAFA2274FB. Address. If I close that down, or actually I can do it from right here, I can just go to name resolution. I can see that that is a Hewlett Packard MAC address. I just found that by clicking name resolution. Next, what's the Windows host name? So I'm going to say close. Now, a common filter that I can use to do this, if I just say frame matches. Now, a lot of Windows machines by default will have the word desktop in them. So, and that's unless they've been changed to something else. So this is kind of a low-hanging fruit thing that I'll do to see if I have that default Windows name there. So I'm just going to hit enter. Nice thing about using frame matches instead of frame contains, matches makes it case irrelevant. So it's not case sensitive. Could be uppercase desktop, lowercase desktop. And I can see right here, this got a couple matches down here on the lower right in my ASCII view. Let me get my head out of the way. I can see that I got desktop-win11pc. So if I come in here to the details, I can see that this machine is checking into an SMTP server, and it's doing basically that hello command, or that hello, hi, how are you? My name is desktop-win11pc. So that's the actual name of the machine that was doing this. Next, what's the user account name? So this is where I can just do a right click. I'm interested in a bit more of this SMTP. Bring myself back in here, and I'm going to go to follow TCP stream, and this will show me this stream data. So there's some interesting stuff in here that we're going to go ahead and pick apart here. First of all, I have an answer for one of the questions that comes down later on, and this is my external IP. So this is the actual public IP address that we are NATed into from this client, right? So we go out with this private address space, and then we're translated into that. That's later on. It's a question down the road. If we come down here to what's actually being exfiltrated, what this client is actually sending out, you see here that it says username and then Windows 11 user. So it looks like that answers that question, Windows 11 user. And then I see the other answers that I need to find, how much RAM, CPU. If I come down here, it's giving a full name. It gives us the name of the desktop machine. Also, here's my CPU, Intel Core i5-13600. And if I come over here to RAM, now this is in K, so 32,000, so that's going to be 32 gigabytes of RAM. Now, my external IP, I find that here. And also I can see that there's a bunch of usernames and passwords that are being sent out. And they're for email clients. So here, Thunderbird. Also, I have, if I keep going down, login US Coca-Cola. Someone likes some soda. And that's actually legitimate Coca-Cola. New York Times, Amazon. So I can see that usernames and passwords are being sent out for clients and web traffic. Okay, so I was able to find all of that, LinkedIn as well. I was able to find all of that from the SMTP traffic, which was sent open. Now, that answers the questions that the exercise had us go through. And if you hit the answer, you can see that those are the answers. And this is how I would have arrived at them. But there's also a couple little small things that I'd like to show you while we're here in this PCAP. All right, so when I have it, you notice that we're actually authenticating to this SMTP server. We're sending a username, we're sending a password. But if you come down here to packet number, let me make sure you're on the same page as me, packet 650, if we come down into the detail view, SMTP, you see it says login. So authentication, login, request parameter, and then username. Okay, so this username is sent encoded. This isn't just the actual username that was typed out. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to right click this, and I'd like you to join me here. Let's go ahead and take a look at show packet bytes. Now from here on that top left, you can see that that same string is there. But what we're going to do is come down here to the bottom where it says decode as, and we're going to decode it as base 64. So this is the actual login. So we were just able to do that right in Wireshark. I wanted to make sure that you all knew how to do that. So there's our login, okay? So I'm just gonna say close. Now let's come back out. Now a couple packets later, we have password. Okay, so if we come down here to password, again, that's gonna be encoded. Let's right click, we're gonna do show packet bytes, and there's our encoded string. Let's actually decode it as base 64. And there is our password for authenticating to that SMTP server. So that's not gonna work with everything because not all usernames and passwords are base 64 encoded. But when we're dealing with a protocol like SMTP that's exchanging that with base 64, we can use that little show packet bytes feature to be able to decode it to base 64 to ASCII right there in Wireshark. So I hope you liked this exercise, taking a look at some Agent Tesla malware, and I will see all of you on another video.